On this, Clopas, we're told by a second century source named Hegesippus, is the uncle of Jesus and also seems to have been married to a woman named Mary. And this would mean that James and Joseph aren't Jesus's literal brothers, but are actually cousins. Now, you don't have to take that, but you don't have to believe Hegesippus. But however you make sense of the evidence, you have to realize that these people called brothers of Jesus have a different mother, and obviously they don't share the same father since Jesus doesn't have a biological father. So then it's like, okay, what do we make of all of that? Well, brother is used in a much more flexible way because there isn't a Hebrew word for cousin, for nephew, for uncle. And so Abraham and Lot, for instance, in Genesis, are referred to as brothers. We know their uncle, nephew. And so brother in this sense should be understood just as kinsman. So that's not a really solid argument against Mary's perpetual virginity. The second one that actually I think backfires is people will point out in Matthew 1, it says that Mary remains a virgin until Jesus is born. And people say, well, it doesn't logically entail that therefore she wasn't a virgin afterwards. And here I would say that this is just a misreading of the text. And I'd say this for a couple of reasons. First, because we're also told in the New Testament that Christ will reign until he's put his enemies under his feet. That's 1 Corinthians 15, verse 25. That doesn't mean Christ is going to stop reigning after his triumph. So until doesn't mean up to this point and not after. It just means up to this point. If I say the music was blaring from the time I got to the party until I left, I'm not saying that they turned the music down as soon as I walked out the door. I'm just demarcating a start and an end point in time. And so then you say, okay, well, why would Matthew be doing that in Matthew 1? In other words, if Matthew's not trying to tell us that Mary had sexual relationships with Joseph after Christmas, why did he say this at all? And Matthew tells us in Matthew 1. He tells us in verse 23 that this is to show the fulfillment of Isaiah 7, which says that a virgin will conceive and bear a child. So if Mary had sexual relationships with Joseph, even though he's her husband, the prophecy wouldn't have been fulfilled because a virgin would have conceived a child, but a virgin wouldn't have born the child. This is a fitting issue to deal with since I'm waiting any day now for my wife to give birth. Bearing a child is an event that happens about 9 months after conceiving a child. So childbirth is like Isaiah 7 points to two moments. There's going to be a virgin conception and virgin childbirth. And so Matthew is telling us that Mary is a virgin at both of these moments. He's not trying to tell us, and then she stopped being a virgin. That is just not true. Rather, I think a couple things are worth noting here. First, we should be wondering, like, why in the world is Mary a virgin when she's giving birth? The angel doesn't tell her she needs to be a virgin. And in fact, Joseph is referred to as her husband. I know some translations will say they're just betrothed or engaged, but under Jewish law, there were two stages to a wedding, and they were legally married, which is why Joseph contemplates divorce. They could have had sexual relations with each other. We know this in part because Jesus goes into the temple, and people just assumed this was the child of Joseph and Mary. If he'd been born out of wedlock, he wouldn't have been allowed in the temple under Mosaic law. So the arguments we should be asking are, why is Mary a virgin when the angel Gabriel comes to her when she's legally married? And then they actually move in together. They live together, which is the second stage of a Jewish wedding, and still Mary's a virgin. But all of that is just sort of suggestive. I think the single clearest piece of evidence is in John 19. At the foot of the cross, Jesus entrusts Mary to the disciple John, a non-relative. So this is a famous woman, behold your son, behold your mother. And this would be absolutely unthinkable if Mary had other children. That if Mary had children she could go and live with, she would have had not only the right to do so, her children have an obligation under the Ten Commandments. When it says, honor your father and mother, this was understood to mean you have to take care of them in their old age. And in fact, the New Testament tells you if you don't do that, you're worse than an unbeliever. And so the idea that Jesus would disrespect his own family at the cross like that by not allowing them to honor their mother is unthinkable. So that's very clear evidence, I would say, of the fact that there are no biological children of Mary other than the one who's dying on the cross right there.
And Aaron, as you could probably guess, we get there because we are a little past time for our break. We'll take that break and be right back with more Open Forum with Joe Heschmeyer, if he's still here when we get back on Catholic Answers Live.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite Monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
This is Father Emil Fajardo. Dear friends, if we understand the power of radio, then we can understand that the gospel can be made very real, very convincing, powerful enough to send shockwaves throughout the whole country and indeed the whole world. Catholic radio is necessary in order that the gospel be sent throughout all the world, and most importantly, a convincing witness of Christ's presence here on earth.
The world needs EWTN Catholic Radio, now more than ever.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest. It's an open forum. You are welcome to call 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Catholic Answers, a bunch of us heading down to Australia, and we really hope that you will come out if you are in the area of Perth and can make it. That will be coming up the second week of October, and it is going to be a fantastic time. I know it is, because last time we did it, it was just one of the best times we've ever had. And here to help us to invite you to come to these big events in Perth is Michael Chong, who is the head honcho. I don't know what the official title is, the boss of Evangelization Australia. Michael, thanks for being with us.
Yeah, good afternoon. Good morning. Good afternoon to everyone.
I should have mentioned that Michael got up before the sun in order to be on with us, because he's on the other side of the earth.
Yes, well, thank you for having me, Si.
Yeah. Just tell us a little bit about what's going to happen and how people can get connected.
Oh, we're so excited to have Catholic Answers down again. I think you remember that the last time you were there was pretty much the last time we had a conference. That was in 2019. Right. And evidently, a few things happened in the interim, but we're back. Things.
Sorry, just to be clear, are you blaming Si for COVID?
He wouldn't be the first person.
Only privately. But now it's okay. Public, so yeah, all right. We're really thankful to be back on board, and we're really thankful that it was almost like a bookend that Catholic Answers should be coming. We are doing something very exciting in Thanksgiving, and it ties in with Joe's book. The conference is going to be entitled Behold, which is all about the Eucharist. I think that the bishops all around the world are calling for a Eucharistic renewal. Pope Francis is calling for a Eucharistic renewal. 2023 yes. In Perth has been marked as a year of Eucharistic and liturgical renewal.
Praise God.
I think all this is coming out of that 2016 Pew Research. But it's just an invitation for folks to take a bit of time away from their daily lives, because, you know, there's COVID, where we were forced to take time away from our daily lives. But I think that there's been a bit of a rebound, and everyone's gone heavier into it. And we're just asking you, look, okay, we've had a couple of years of recovery. We've had a couple of years of really heavy activity. Let's take a bit of time away and let's talk about the Eucharist. Let's focus on the Eucharist and our relationship with the Eucharist. As Joe was saying, if your Eucharistic theology is wrong, all kinds of things can go wrong. And our Archbishop himself said, we cannot be an effective witness to the Church without the Eucharist. So the whole conference is about the Eucharist. Conference dates, 12th to the 14th of October. We are having some primer events, some lead-in events, parish events on the 10th and 11th. All this is available on our website, which is evangelizationaustralia.com, and that's with an S, Si, as you keep reminding us. Mm-hmm. That's evangelization.
Yes. With an S.
Yeah. Intentionally, we did it intentionally, so that you and I can have something to talk about. So evangelizationaustralia.com, and all the dates and all the topics and all the speakers are on there. How to register is on there. It's designed really to be like a mini Easter. We'll start with catechetics on Tuesday and Wednesday, move on to the conference proper with a cross moment. We'll have a resurrection moment and we'll have a mission moment. So it's really, really, first of all, it's really good to be back, but it's really exciting to share, this whole week, all about the Eucharist and Jesus.
That is just wonderful, Michael. So if people want to come to the preparatory or lead up events, they can find all of that too at Evangelization Australia.
Yes, they can. Yes, they can. The good news about the prep events at the parishes, they're free. There's no charge. There's a fee for registering for the conference, of course, but well worth it for the 3 days. We have a Thanksgiving Mass on Wednesday, which is going to be the main celebrant is the Archbishop Emeritus Hickey. Auxiliary Bishop Don Sproxton is celebrating the opening Mass on Thursday. Then we'll have, Si, maybe you can give a brief talk about, rattle out some titles about what you'll be talking about.
Well, I mean, I really appreciated, and I think Tim Staples is going to be there. Dr. Stacy Trusankos will be there as well. And you gave us a kind of roadmap of what to talk about. And so, from the introductory, there's a theme as we go through, and each theme I'll be doing a different talk on. And I am kind of particularly fired up. I know this sounds odd to do on Thursday when you're talking about suffering, when you're focusing on suffering. I do think that one of the ways that we draw people back to the Eucharist is to remind people that Christ does not abandon us in our suffering, but wants to walk with us, be with us, heal us, help us, encourage us. And that's all stuff that we want to have. So it's not a burden to come back to the Eucharist. It's a laying our suffering at the foot of the cross and having a Lord who knows everything we've gone through and going through it with us.
Absolutely. And I think that's something that, on the one hand, Catholics speak well of, because we have a formed theology on suffering. But on the other hand, I don't think everyone is aware of that. So the theme for that evening is not my will, but your will be done. Similarly, on Saturday morning, it will be I'm the bread, I'm the living bread, come down from heaven. And then Saturday afternoon is behold, I make all things new. So you're right, every session has a theme, and they're all meant to lead us to that mountaintop experience, which is Holy Week, which is Jesus, which is the Eucharist.
Praise God, Michael. EvangelizationAustralia.com. Put an S in evangelization, and you can find out all about it. EvangelizationAustralia.com. Michael Chong, we're so blessed to be able to be associated with you and the folks at Evangelization Australia, especially Joe. And I just wanted to say thanks that we're getting to come down there again.
Thank you very much. We're very excited. It's only 4 weeks to go, three and a bit, but you leave for New Zealand a little bit earlier than that. So we're stoked to have you come aboard again.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael. Now go outside and watch the sunrise.
I will. Okay. Take care, guys. God bless.
Thanks very
much. We're sending it your way.
Yeah, we're almost done with it. You could have it in a few minutes. The number is 888-318-7884, 888-31-TRUTH. Our guest is Joe Heschmeyer, and you're welcome to ask him whatever you want. It's funny, talking to Michael, I was thinking about, he's the reason that you didn't get to tell your family that you were expecting your third child. Because remember, you said to Chris and I in confidence, I can't go to Australia with you. There's going to be a new baby then. And then Chris promptly went on the air and told everyone that you had a new baby coming.
Maybe we should name him after Michael instead.
The new baby?
I'm not going to do that. Actually, Society 315 members already know the baby's name, I think. Oh, so if you become a monthly giver and you read your emails, you probably already know the baby's name.
Did the first, didn't do the second, although I saw the email that Michelle sent. I didn't
want to call you out. I kind of assumed the answer to both of those questions.
You know me. I will get to the emails. The baby will be in college, but I'll get to the email. Yeah. All right, let's go to John in Mount Vernon, Illinois, listening on Catholic.com. John, thank you for waiting. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Thank you, Si. Congratulations, Joe.
Thank you.
Now, my question is, what is grace? It seems to mean different things in different contexts.
Yes, that's a good insight. It does. Grace is literally favor. It's God's favor. But what that means in context depends on who's speaking and what they're speaking about. And so we classically define a few different types of grace. So the Catechism actually has very good language on this, right around 2000. So right before and right after paragraph 2000. And so in paragraph 2024, it makes a few important distinctions. First, the first kind of grace that's relevant for our life is what's called sanctifying grace. And so again, grace just means God's favor. We don't have to make it anything kind of fancy. But God sanctifies us, and this is a grace. This is a favor that he does for us. He brings us from being unholy, and he makes us holy. That's what sanctifying grace is. It makes us pleasing to God. But then along the Christian journey, two things are true. One, we're preserved in that being pleasing to God, not in a momentary like, oh, well, right now I'm in it, right now I'm out, but in a habitual way, meaning that if you are saved, if you're in right relationship with God, if you're in a state that's pleasing to him, he is preserving you there. Now, you can break that through mortal sin. And this is an area we disagree with some Protestants. But the fact that you're not in a state of sin and unbelief and all of that is a perpetual kind of grace. It's an ongoing, the technical term is a habitual grace. And so that's what we mean by habitual grace. And St. Paul talks about this grace in Romans chapter 5, verse 5, when he says that God's love has been poured into our heart through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. So if you think about the working of the Holy Spirit, there are times where the Holy Spirit acts on you in a particular time and place and way, Pentecost, for instance, or charisms. We'll get into all of that. But then there's also this sense Paul talks about in which the Holy Spirit is just present in your life in this enduring way, we'd say a habitual way. That's what we mean by habitual grace. But then you also have charisms, which are really closely connected, because these are special graces given by the Holy Spirit for a particular purpose for the upbuilding of the church. And St. Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians 12. There's plenty of other places in Scripture that speak of this. There are certain supernatural gifts that are graces given. You may not have it forever. You might have it in a particular time and place where God gives you a special insight, perhaps, to handle a problem. You know, someone calls you in a crisis, and you get a special gift of God of just doing exactly what to say. That is a grace. That's not a habitual grace. You can't count on that a week from now, but that's the other kind. So we want to talk about actual graces, is what those are called, and charisms.
John, thank you very much. You can hear the music. Time for a break. We will take a very quick break and be right back with more Open Forum with Bo Heschmeyer. There's a line open, 888-318-7884. When the resurrected Jesus appeared to disciples on the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize him until the breaking of the bread. The same is true today. In the Holy Eucharist, we really meet Jesus. In The Eucharist is Really Jesus, author Joe Heschmeyer explains how knowing Jesus in the Eucharist is the key to understanding all of Christian faith. Order your copy of The Eucharist is Really Jesus today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to casociety315.com and join today.
Is relativism dead? It sure seems dead. Each day, new moral demands are made and they are presented to us as absolutes. Everything from transgender ideology to physician-assisted suicide is presented as a moral good that all right-thinking people must accept. But Catholic Answer's own Carlo Broussard says look deeper, and you will see today's moralism is just relativism dressed up in new clothes. Carlo's eye-opening book, The New Relativism, shines a light on how the sacred moral teachings of this age cover up a deep denial of moral truth. Order your copy of The New Relativism today at shop.catholic.com and be prepared to defend the truth against aggressive relativism. The New Relativism at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hi, this is Johnette Williams. We bring you the truth of the Catholic faith on Women of Grace tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. 2 hours of open forum today. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest, and just about every line full. So back to the phones we will go. Eva is in Ontario watching on YouTube.
Yeah, can I just say something real quick? Yeah. I just watched WALL-E or part of it with my kids before they got distracted, which was super cute because my son just kept saying, robot! Like he was just, that was as much of the plot as he seemed to get. But I'm taking everything in my power not to do Eva in the voice WALL-E does.
I had no idea where you were going with that. I just thought, is Joe having a moment here? Why is he even, he's just going to, wait, can I just interrupt the show early to talk about a movie I watched with my kids?
Yeah, I mean, if you've never seen WALL-E, it's a good
one. I haven't seen it. I should watch it probably.
It's solid.
I think Eva's an old friend of ours, if I remember. Eva, are you there with us?
Yes, hello.
It is our old friend, Eva. Nice to talk with you again.
Yes, I'm glad I'm calling in again.
Well, we're always glad when you call. So what do you got for Joe?
Well, certain Protestants seem to think that the King James Version of the Bible is either the most reliable version or the only reliable translation. And I've met some Protestants that are like this that will not accept anything unless you read it to them out of the King James Bible. And so I was wondering, why would some Protestants think that the King James Bible is superior or the only good translation? And how could you show them that it's not, and even in other translations that are Protestant, the King James Bible is not the best?
Yeah, okay. If you want other sources from a Protestant, Tevin Wax of the Gospel Coalition has an article from like 2007 called The King James Only Controversy. Trevin Wax, excuse me, T-R-E-V-I-N. And he goes into a lot of the major arguments used and why those arguments aren't really true. So I want to just say at the beginning, I think a lot of the appeal of King James onlyism is the idea that people get scandalized by the fact that there's different translations of the Bible that say different things. Now, these differences are pretty small for the most part. But someone's like, well, if God wants to reveal himself and I don't speak Greek or Hebrew, I need a reliable English version of the Bible. And so there's the idea that maybe God inspired a translation into English. Now, none of that is biblical. I mean, there's nothing in scripture that says God is going to inspire a translation into English so we don't have to take the time to learn Hebrew or Greek. That's just, you know, Americans not wanting to learn foreign languages. There's no theological basis for this. And if it were true, then it'd be like, okay, so is there a divinely inspired translation into Spanish? And then I've actually seen KJV only people push back and say no, because English is a universal language
and more than Spanish
apparently.
Wow.
And why not Chinese? But anyway, if you're going to take that argument seriously, you'd also have to say, well, you know, prior to English in its modern form, which is really only around the 16th century that people start to speak the way we do now, the language that was very commonly spoken in the non-Greek speaking part of Europe was Latin. So much so that even German speakers like Martin Luther post the 95 Theses in Latin because everybody speaks Latin if they know how to read. So why wouldn't God have inspired the Vulgate translation of the Bible, which, amazingly, KJV-only activists think isn't a divinely inspired translation? So the argument doesn't make a ton of sense, even just at a 20,000-foot level. In the weeds, one of the most common arguments I've seen is that allegedly there were two transmission lines. There was a good one that went through Antioch and a bad one that went through Alexandria. And now that is bad biblical scholarship, but then it's kind of bolstered by the fact that, oh, well, Antioch is good because it was in Antioch that Christians were first called that. But Alexandria was bad because a lot of sin is connected to Egypt. But then you could do just as easily the same sort of special pleading in reverse. Well, the Holy Family goes to Egypt to get away from Herod, so Egypt is good. And Christians were persecuted in Antioch, so Antioch is bad. You know, one of the earliest heresies, Arianism, is coming from Antioch and is rebutted by a saint called Athanasius of Alexandria. So you could play the Antioch-Alexandria game back and forth however you wanted to. It's based on a series of very strange kind of views of the Bible and very questionable kind of history. But basically, it comes down to this. The King James Version was based on biblical scholarship of the day. Since that time, we've discovered tons of manuscripts that have been helpful for getting more precise translation. And so we actually have the ability to translate the Bible a little bit better now than we did in the Middle Ages or in the early Reformation period, because we have more manuscripts to work with. We're in a privileged position now. And so all of the arguments that would support the King James Version don't really make a lot of sense. If you want to read the Bible untranslated, learn Koine Greek, learn Hebrew. But if you're content to receive the Bible in English, just realize that no translation is going to perfectly capture all of the beauty and nuance of either the Greek or the Hebrew.
What do you think, Eva?
Okay, thank you. Yeah. And I heard that the King James Bible is actually one of the worst translations out there.
Oh no! I think that's pushing too far in the other direction. There are places where it's beautiful. One thing I do find sort of interesting about this is KJV only Protestants will sometimes say the King James Version 1611, but they don't use the 1611 because that has seven books that aren't in Protestant Bibles, the so-called Apocrypha. They usually use the 1789 edition, which actually has tons of changes from the 1611. So even the people making the King James Version didn't believe they were divinely inspired translators. So it's a strange kind of position to hold, and it doesn't, no serious biblical scholar would agree with that position. And so it's always just these popularizers who don't really understand the history of the textual transmission.
Okay, thank you very much.
Absolutely.
I'm so glad we got to talk with you again, Eva. Call anytime. Thank you very much. The number here is 888-318-7884. I looked while you were talking with Eva. The Spanish has 105 million more first language speakers than English does.
There you go.
But as a second language,
English. It's the lingua franca, so to speak, which I really enjoy because that just means the French language.
Spanish is the lingua franca. But as a second language, there's a billion people that speak English as their second language.
Yeah, I think is actually the argument they'd make, is lots of people who don't speak English natively still speak it as a second language. But that is literally the role Latin played much of the history of Europe.
Right.
That even if you spoke Italian or Greek or German or Old English, if you were the type of person who was going to learn to read, like a merchant or a cleric or whatever, you were going to learn Latin. It was the common second language. So you could have situations, you know, St. Thomas Aquinas is from Italy. He studies under Albert the Great from Germany at the University of Paris in France. And it all works harmoniously because it's all in Latin. And so all of this would be, all of the KJV only arguments would actually be better arguments for the Vulgate being an inspired translation. But we don't usually go down that road.
we don't indeed. That's just not the way we think about translations. But Eva, right. Again, thank you very much for the call. Brian's in Iowa, listening to EWTN on Sirius XM satellite radio, channel 130. Brian, thanks for the call. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Yeah, Joe, thanks for taking my call.
Yeah, absolutely.
As you described the Eucharist in the beginning of the show, why aren't people healed when they touch it? because the woman touched his garment and was healed. I don't remember the scriptures, but I'm sure
Yeah, no, that's a good description. She is asking in faith, and she has so much faith that she knows, if I so much as touch his garment, I'll be healed. But plenty of people touch Jesus and aren't immediately healed. So, you know, Jesus's body doesn't work just, you know, like magic or something. It isn't that the Roman soldiers nailing him to the cross suddenly find, like, oh, I feel a lot better now. I think it must be from touching that guy I was crucifying. It does, you know, touching his body without faith doesn't produce any kind of miraculous effects. And so we don't want to treat Christ's body as if, I mean, almost in like a superstitious or magical way. Like, his body is certainly the source of miracles. And so power flows out from his body, but it's interconnected intricately to faith. And so that the question it should raise is, well, if we believe fervently, will Christ work miracles if we go to him approaching the Eucharist in that spirit of faith? And I think the answer to that is yes. Not 100% of the time, not in a way we can set our watch to, but in his own good pleasure. I think there's plenty of people who have been miraculously healed, both from spiritual and physical maladies, because they approach the Eucharist in faith.
All right. Well, thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you, Brian. Thanks very, very much for the call. It's about time, but we got to take a break, so we'll take that break. But this is one thing that Tim Staples says quite a bit on our air, is that we should do a better job of talking about Eucharistic miracles. Just for this reason.
I think that's so true.
People, because there are many, many people have been healed by the Eucharist. It's, again, Brian, thank you for the call. We'll take a quick break. We'll come back with more Joe. If you'd like to get in the queue to ask your question, 888-318-7884.
Hang on. We'll be right back with more Catholic Answers Live.
The Catechism defines evangelization as the proclamation of Christ and his gospel by word and the testimony of life. But what does that look like in real life? It looks like St. Paul street evangelists out in the public square sharing the good news. We're a Catholic nonprofit that starts conversations by handing out free sacramentals. Then we employ our method of listen, befriend, proclaim, and invite. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. Visit streetevangelization.com to learn more.
Hey, this is Michael O'Neill, the Miracle Hunter. I'll be delving into the fascinating world of miracles and taking you on a hunt that explores the greatest mysteries and marvels of the Catholic Church. I'll be examining what constitutes a miracle, how miracles are investigated and approved, and the role they play in the lives of the faithful. We'll look at the miracles of the Gospels and early Christianity, considering the claims of the miraculous in our own modern age.
The Miracle Hunter, Saturday at 1 p.m. and 7 p.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Back to Catholic Answers Live. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest. It's open forum. Your calls are welcome. 888-318-7884 is the number. And when the lines are this full, I just like to keep going from caller to caller. And off we go to San Antonio, Texas, where Daniel is watching on YouTube. Daniel, thank you for the call. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hey, Joe. Hey, Si. How's it going, guys?
Really good.
How are you?
Sorry about that. Hey, Joe, so I understand what we don't mean in the creed by the Son being God and not made. Mm-hmm. And I kind of understand what we mean by begotten, but when I think about it a little more, I get a bit confused.
Yeah.
And I know it's like, I think it's more to means to be caused to be. Does that mean... Is it because of the relationship between the Father and the Son?
Yeah, so there never was a time the Son was not.
Right. So he's not created. I understand that's not what it means.
Right. And he's not distinct from the Father in terms of his essence, which is the other thing created means. Like, what you create isn't, right. It is not you in that essential kind of way, where obviously the Father is not the Son. But they do, they are one in being, they are consubstantial. And so those are the things we're preserving in the language of begetting. But the other half of that, which is what you're pointing to, is there is a first person, second person, third person of the Holy Trinity, that there's not a temporal priority, meaning there's not a sequence in time where the Father's older than the Son. There is still a sort of an eternal proceeding, that the Father begets the Son is begotten by the Father. So the origin or principle is in the Father, and it flows through the Son. And in this Father-Son dynamic, the fruit of that is the Holy Spirit. It's very hard not to think of that as a relationship in time. I mean, this is an insane analogy, but this is the one that when I was studying this stuff, I found useful. And it's probably going to be unhelpful to anyone who isn't me, but I'll give it a shot.
Which is everyone else.
Yeah.
Just in case you didn't know, Joe. That's everyone.
I know. This
under...
is, I'm downplaying the goodness of this analogy so much, and you're going to understand why.
All right. Here we go.
If you had two eternally old objects, so I've got a cup on a table, and imagine, hypothetically, they're eternally old. The table is still upholding the cup. It has a fundamental priority in one sense because of gravity, right? That the cup is not upholding the table is upholding the cup. And we're used to thinking about those things in time. There was a time the table was here, the cup wasn't on the table. But even if that weren't true, there would still be that logical relationship where you could walk in the room and say that cup is upholding the table. I don't know if that helps at all, but this idea is that when we say the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, first, second, third person, we don't mean a priority in time. We mean a priority just in the order and kind of the ontology within God.
Daniel?
Yeah, yeah. So that helps a decent amount.
All right. It's okay, helped two people now.
You know what?
It's helped you and Joe.
That is literally one more person I thought it would ever help. So it was, because it is a hard thing. I really like the language the Fourth Lateran Council uses. They condemn some accidental mistakes made by an abbot named Joachim. And in there, they explain the movement within the Holy Trinity in a way that I think is very helpful. So if you pull up the Fourth Lateran Council, it's 1215, and look at the errors of the Abbot Joachim, when you see their response, the way they kind of explain it at a decent length, this interplay within the Trinity, that was also helpful for me. It maybe is a little greater authority than a couple items like a cup and a table. But, you know, so you know, it's understood. Look, at the end of the day, if you say, I don't fully get this, welcome to the club, because we're dealing with things higher than us. A God we can comprehend isn't God.
Yeah, that makes sense. And I just always go back to what I know it doesn't mean.
Yes.
But I was trying to get a better grasp on it since I was listening to a podcast on the Filioque.
And
they
okay.
get pretty
nice.
Deep into it, you know.
Yes. This is why, actually, relatedly, I find this as a source of division to be a little strange, because I think 90-some-odd% of the people who get really animated about the Filioque don't have a very clear sense of what it is they're upset about in terms of what does this mean for the Holy Spirit to proceed from the Father and the Son, or from the Holy Spirit to proceed from the Father.
Yeah, you got to do some pretty high-level theology even to be upset by that.
Right. I think more people are upset about the idea of it than actually, like, how does this impact my conception of God or my relationship with God in even the slightest way.
Daniel, thanks very much. I'll tell you what, if you hang on the line, I want to send you a copy of Joe's book. And if I say the title of it correctly right now, I'm going to send the copy to you. If I get it wrong, no copy. The Eucharist
looks like I'm not going to get it, Si.
No, here we go. The Eucharist is really Jesus. I think I got it now.
Yeah, you got it.
I got it. So you get it, Daniel.
There you go. Hang on.
Yeah, thanks for the vote of confidence. I'll tell you what.
When it comes to hosting, I got full confidence in you, Si.
Oh, that send him two books. Find another
Speaking
book to
of
send
things
him.
That there's like one more person than we expected.
Yeah, that's not funny, Joe. Don't say things like that.
Yeah.
All right, Daniel, hang on. We'll send you those books. Andrew is in Massachusetts watching on YouTube. Andrew, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Yes, I was watching the Catechism in a Year podcast the other day.
Was with Father Mike Schmitz? Because that's the
podcast.
Only one worth watching.
Yes, indeed.
Okay, good. You don't take second best.
Oh, you're going to just say the only podcast worth watching, even though we have a whole network of podcasts.
No, the only Catechism in a Year podcast is worth watching. All right, so that brought up a question for you, Andrew.
Yes. So Father Mike was talking about CCC 1938 mm-hmm. that talks about sinful inequalities that exist. Mm-hmm. And I'm just wondering if the inequalities itself that's sinful, or if it's the vast numbers of people that are like in poverty. Because like from my economic understanding, inequality wouldn't be the problem. It would be poverty. So I'm just wondering how to properly understand this point of the catechism.
That's a really good question. So in one sense, inequality is of God and is willed by God. And that is always like shocking for people to hear, but it's really clearly in scripture. Take the parable of the talents. God gives one 5, another 2 talents, and a third 1. So it's showing that there's inequality built in. It's not just financial inequality, it's inequality in skills. I mean, literally, our English word talent to mean like something you're good at comes from the parable of the talent. We realize these are given by God, but he gives more talents to some people than others. Some people are just more talented than you, and that's okay. So whatever you think, like think about the broadest sense of all of God's gifts and blessings. Some people are going to be more blessed. And this is, Aquinas argues, good and beautiful, that the order of creation shows this. There's humans are above animals, which are above plants, which are above rocks and stuff. And this is actually a way of making the universe more beautiful than if everything was exactly the same. And he says the universe would not be perfect if only one grade of goodness were found in things. So there's one sense of inequality that is actually good and God-given. But then the question is, what do we do with this inequality? Why does God want this inequality to exist as a starting place? And it's so that we will take care of each other. And this is where sinful inequality comes in. The reason it's a problem that you have massive inequality in wealth is because there are people who are starving next to people who could take care of them and just choose not to. And that's sinful, where it wouldn't be sinful if someone's starving and the person next to them is starving. They'd help if they could, but they're no better off. You see the problem? So there's a moral issue in the second case, which is you could solve the problem and are choosing not to. The reason inequality is given to us by God is so we can take care of each other. The rich and the poor exist for the sake of one another. And, you know, in the language of St. Paul, all of the gifts of God are given for the equipment of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. That's Ephesians 4:12. And so we will be judged based on how we use the gifts and talents we've been given. The person who is more talented than you is going to be judged more harshly than you, because they'll be judged on what they did with 5 talents, and maybe you've only got 2. And so Jesus gives this standard in Luke 12:48, that to whom much is given, much will be expected. To whom more is given, more will be expected. So if you are rich, whether that's financially rich, whether that just means you're really good at stuff, whether that means you're rich in having the gift of the faith, you should know this is not for your private enjoyment. This gift is given to you to share with others. And if you don't do that, you will be condemned for it. And so that's the kind of strong word. It's easy to either say inequality of itself is inherently bad. That's an easy answer, but false. Or God gives you different gifts and talents, so just go eat, drink, and be merry. And that is actually a condemned way of dealing with the gifts that you've been given. That's the fool that Jesus condemns in the New Testament. So I'd say, given all of that, the issue with sinful inequality that the Catechism's talking about is not the inequality we find in nature, but how we respond to those inequalities, which unfortunately too often is retreating into selfishness.
Andrew?
That makes a lot of sense. And yes, I would definitely agree about not helping people that are starving and stuff like that. So that makes a lot of sense. And thank you very much for clarifying that.
Absolutely. It's an issue I'm really interested in and think that is kind of an underexplored part of the Christian message. That, look, even in the angelic hierarchy, you have angels and archangels, thrones and dominions, principalities and powers, cherubim, seraphim, you have all these different choirs or ranks or orders of angels. But why is that? Because the ones at the top can reveal the goodness of God to the ones below them. And Aquinas makes this point in the Summa that the reason we see inequality even within creation is that God is infinitely good. And if everyone just revealed the same aspect of God's goodness, you would get a very small insight into the goodness of God. But as it is, you see something of the grandeur of God in the flowers. You see something else of the grandeur of God in the cosmos and these incredible things like supernovae. You see something else in the grandeur of God in the old lady that you meet to have tea with. That there's something in every person and every even non-person you meet in creation that reveals something of the goodness of God. And so it's good that we're all different. St. Paul uses the imagery of the body of Christ, and I think that is right on the money and just really viscerally capturing it. He says it's not good. You know, the ear shouldn't want to be an eye. Like, sure, the eye can do a lot of things the ear can't, but if the body was just eyes, that would be freaky. He doesn't say it quite like that, but that's not good. We want to be able to hear. We don't want to just be able to see. And so it's good that you've got different talents than the person next to you. And so we have to root out that spirit we can fall into of envy or of pride that we have gifts that our neighbor doesn't, or just that spirit of comparison of saying, I wish I was like this other person, or I'm not doing a good job because I'm not like this other person. God doesn't want you to be your neighbor. He wants you to be the saint that he made you to be.
Can I just tell you something before you go, Andrew? What I really, I must say, I really appreciated your question. And it does seem to me that the Lord spoke so much about wealth and poverty. And we Christians spend time talking about almost anything but sometimes. But it does seem that what you did was you see a word like inequality that's often misused in our political debate. And you say, well, what does the church mean by that? Because yeah. The church doesn't mean what a political party means by it, or what a TV commenter or radio commenter means by it. The church has her own meaning for these things. And I do appreciate that that's what you did. Instead of rejecting it, you said, well, what's the church mean by that, Andrew?
Thank you. Yeah, I'm always trying to learn. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Would you bet that I could give the correct title of Joe's book or not?
I think you could probably do it.
Okay, then if I do it, you're going to get a free copy of it. Just hang on the line if I do it. The Eucharist is really Jesus.
I feel like you might have written that down. You did that a little too confidently that time.
Well, I didn't say I didn't. That's not cheating. I never said anything about it. I just asked him if he thought I could do it. Andrew, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity for a very helpful and enlightening conversation as well. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest, still expecting his third child, at least yes. As far as we know.
He'll be right back. Picture from the hospital.
More questions for Joe. You can get in line, 888-318-7884.
Thank you.
back. Catholic Answers Live. Awful glad you're here with us. Thank you for being here with us. Joe Heschmeyer's here with us. He's our guest this hour. And you are welcome to call and ask him whatever you like about the Catholic faith, whether you're Catholic or not. 888-318-7884. That's what we do on Open Forum. We take calls from anybody on any aspect of the Catholic faith. And if we know the answer, we'll give it to you for free. 888-318-7884. Joe and I divide up the questions. He takes 100% of them, and I take the rest that are left over. Joe Heschmeyer, thanks for being back here with us.
It's good to be back. That is technically a dividing, I guess, one over one.
There was like, I think it was a player, I can't remember, but do you remember Wilt Chamberlain once scored 100 points in Hershey, Pennsylvania? Do you know that Wilt Chamberlain had 100
points? I did not know that.
There was another player on the team that used to tell people he always remembered the night that he and Wilt combined for 101 points. I can't remember. Maybe that's an apocryphal story. I don't know, but I do think it's funny. Because I think you and I are doing a great job answering the questions, Joe. I think you and I are doing a fine job.
I have a related hockey stat. I just looked it up to double check.
All right.
The NHL record for most points scored by a pair of brothers.
Yeah.
Is by the Gretzky brothers, but it's divided a little bit unevenly. Four of those points are by Brent Gretzky and 2,857 are by Wayne.
So, but the two of them combined, that's a wonderful number.
Yeah. They beat every other pair of brothers.
Well, as you said, the last hour, we are all different in our talents.
Yes. And I'm not claiming to be the Wayne Gretzky of this at all. I just
no, like you are the Wayne Gretzky of apologists. I think what you're saying is you're the Wayne Gretzky, Wilt Chamberlain of apologetics, and Joe DiMaggio as well. All right. And the greatest football player, who's the greatest football player? And Joe Namath.
I think he meant Patrick Mahomes.
Oh, I forgot you're from Kansas City.
I am from Kansas City. This is a bad week to mention it. We just lost, but it turns out to be successful as a quarterback, you can't just be really good at throwing. Someone also has to be able to catch the ball.
It's a team sport. And,
turns out,
I remember there was a game where, Tom Brady's wife tweeted out something to that effect after the game, like, well, he threw it good, but they wouldn't catch it.
I think yikes.
Tom probably had to say to her, you know, that's not really how a team works.
Yeah, maybe like, don't put hexes on the other players.
Right.
She's a witch for the record. I don't mean that in a pejorative. I mean in the literal sense.
Wait, who's a witch?
Tom Brady's wife. Ex-wife now.
Ex-wife, yeah.
She practiced witchcraft. He actually got into it himself. It's a really unfortunate story.
Oh, I didn't know anything about that. You mean like a Wicca-type witch or another
kind
of witch?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, and so he attributed a lot of his success of doing stuff with this dark art.
Oh, no. Man, you really brought the show down, Joe.
Hey,
holy
here's
smokes.
Some fun sports anecdotes. And yeah. By the way, if you needed another reason not to root for Tom Brady.
Wow. Wow, Joe Heschmeyer. He's a Patrick Mahomes fan, and he hates everyone else. What is
not true. I just wish Tom Brady went about things in a more honorable manner spiritually.
Okay. Wow, you are way out on a limb there. welcome to all our Boston listeners. Thanks for joining
us. Catholic Cullen Show.
888-318-7884 is the number. If you want to call and complain about that last statement, please do. I can't wait to hear that conversation between you and Joe.
I hope they aren't feeling too deflated.
Oh, no. Come on. Please, Joe. Please. Not acceptable. Just not acceptable.
Waiting for a Brady bunch of calls.
888-318-7884. Oh, you know what? Though we're not going to the phones right away because Thomas the TikTok engine is here to ask a TikTok question. Thomas, please, no sports puns and don't get Joe started again. Just act like it didn't happen and go on, please.
I'm sorry. I just have to I have to think about it. If Joe's the Wayne Gretzky of apologetics, then like, what does that make someone like me? Am I like the, I don't know, the bench player on the World Series team or something?
You're gritty.
You're the Brett Gretzky.
I'm like gritty. Oh, thanks, Joe. Okay. Hey, he's actually one of the best
the adorable mascots. Yeah.
He's actually one of the best accounts on TikTok, I'll have you know. So that's a better compliment than you thought it was.
You are the Fernando Tatis of apologetics.
That's all I need to hear. Whatever the steroids version of apologetics is, then that's what I'll be on.
Now, you guys are so negative.
I'm a Padres fan, Si. It's in my blood. Okay.
Just ask.
I'm anti-witchcraft. I'm sorry, Si. I know these are
all right. So you guys picking the real hard targets: witchcraft and steroids. You were really
that's right.
Which are really moral spiritual witchcraft and you know physical witchcraft.
Thomas, please, I beg you, ask the question so we can get this over with.
Okay, this is a Catholic Answers show, correct? Just so, yes. Just so I'm clear. All right. So this question came from our TikTok channel. That's why I'm here, is so that Joe could answer it for me. Joe, this person wants to know if Catholics could give him an example of taking veneration too far, improperly worshiping a saint.
That's a good question, but I think it's actually a little bit malformed. And by that, I mean, there's this idea that many people have that worship is just like a little too much respect, a little too much veneration. But veneration and worship are two different things. And so we distinguish them by talking about latria, like worship, adoration, and dulia, which is honor. You can honor your mother and father. You can honor civil authority. You can honor people that you love. You can honor great Christians that you know here on earth. You can honor great Christians in heaven. Nothing about that is dangerous. All of that is good and laudatory. Now, there is a way to worship, but that's a different thing in kind. In the same way that you don't have to say, well, how good of friends am I with someone before we're husband and wife? It's like, no, those are just different things. They're related in some way, but they're different things. You don't have to worry about, like, am I too close to my friend? Does that mean we're dating now? No, it doesn't. It's a different category entirely. Well, likewise, latria and dulia are different categories. And so an example of worshiping Mary or worshiping the saints would be offering the Mass to them, where you offer Jesus's body and blood to them. There was a small sect in early Christianity that tried to do this with Mary and was quickly condemned by the Catholic Church because that is actually idolatry. Or worshiping Mary and saying she's worthy of divine honor. Asking her for her prayers is no more that than asking you or me for prayers would be.
Okay, so it sounds like the real distinction is not so much one of degree, but of like what kind of honor
yes,
you're giving
exactly.
her.
Yeah. It is not a question of degree. It is entirely a question of kind. In the same way that friendship and romantic love is not a difference of degree. Now, there is a sense in which we can say romantic love is maximal friendship, but that doesn't mean being really good friends with someone means that you're in love.
Great. Thanks, Joe.
Yeah, you bet.
Thanks, Thomas Talk Engine. Thanks very much. Joe, I've started to notice when Thomas is on recently. I don't know why I didn't notice it first, but do you notice what a good radio voice he has? He sounds really good.
Yeah, he actually would be really good. We've been talking about how we need a good host for this show.
Oh, yeah. You're looking in the wrong place. I mean, it's Cy. I would be a fantastic host. Yeah.
I like what you
said. I need to gather myself. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more calls, and maybe the baby will come and we'll get a different guest for the rest of the hour right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Stay with us for more Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Magnificat. Published monthly, Magnificat features daily Mass, prayers, articles, and meditations in step with the liturgical rhythm of the Church. On the web at magnificat.com.
EWTN uses the power of radio to reach people whenever and wherever they're searching for answers to questions about their Catholic faith. EWTN Radio is heard on over 500 domestic and international AM and FM radio affiliates. For a complete list of programs and how to hear EWTN Radio, visit EWTN.com and click radio. EWTN, the global Catholic network.
Back to Catholic Answers Live. Joe Heschmeyer in a canceling mood today. Careful, you're going to get canceled. you're canceling. You tried to cancel me before the break.
I thought you were going to say canceling Tom Brady, but he already canceled himself. That's what retirement is.
Retirement is not being canceled, Joe. That's not at all.
Now we're going to get a lot of calls from people who have time on their hand to call us.
Boy,
only in Tom Brady's case. I don't mean that against real retirees.
You are determined to make enemies today. Eric in Arkansas, please save us. Eric's watching on YouTube. Go ahead with your question, Eric.
Hey there. Hi. Congratulations on the baby.
Oh, thank you very much.
I'm expecting a son myself in December.
Hey, congratulations,
Eric. You know what babies love? And I'm going to give one to you. They love books about the Eucharist. So if you hang on afterwards, I'm going to give you The Eucharist is Really Jesus, Joe's new book on the Eucharist. Enjoy and let that baby enjoy.
I think he worked that in seamlessly.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Yeah. You're very welcome.
What's your question, Eric?
He just wanted to tell us that he's got a baby coming in December. He's got a question. My bad. Okay, sorry, Eric. Go ahead.
So when I believe it's Paul is listing out the conditions for a deacon or a bishop, and he says that he's supposed to be the husband of one wife and then list out some other virtues and, be a good head of household and have his children mm-hmm. under control. I have a friend who places a lot of importance on that as almost prescriptive and then mm-hmm. Uses that to kind of argue against the church and priest celibacy. And so I was kind of wondering what the response to that would be so I can answer him a little better on that because I don't view it that way, but I'm not sure how to express that.
Okay. Yeah, that's a great question. So it should be very clear that Paul is talking about a ceiling and not a floor. He's not saying you need at least one wife. He's saying you need at most one wife. And, you can't be a divorcee. Because under Jewish law, you could divorce your wife and remarry. And under pagan law, there was all sorts of stuff you could get away with. And a bishop shouldn't be doing anything like that. And so you don't want to have, here's the bishop's ex-wives. That's what Paul is talking about. How do we know he's not talking about how celibates aren't allowed to be bishops? Because Paul oversees the church and is a celibate himself and talks about this. In 1 Corinthians 7, he argues that it's a higher spiritual state than being married. And for that matter, Jesus. So if the Protestant read was correct, Jesus wouldn't be allowed to be a bishop because he doesn't have a wife or kids. And it seems very weird to have a rule that disqualifies Jesus from governing his own church. And so in Matthew 19, Jesus talks about the superiority of celibacy. So after he lays out his vision of marriage, which is that divorce and remarriage is sinful, the disciples are scandalized and shocked by this. And they say, if such is the case of a man with his wife, it is not expedient to marry. And Jesus doesn't disagree. He says in verse 11, this is Matthew 19, verse 11, not all men can receive this precept, but only those to whom it is given. For there are eunuchs who have been so from birth, and there are eunuchs who have been made eunuchs by men, and there are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. He who is able to receive this, let him receive it. So if Jesus has just said, if you can do it, if you can practice celibacy for the sake of the kingdom, you should. That is completely inconsistent with saying you have to not do that in order to be a bishop in the church. And so this is a case of just taking like one line completely and radically out of context and putting it against the whole of the rest of what the New Testament has to say about how marriage is. So you got three categories. You've got being aflame with lust, as St. Paul puts it, that's bad. You have marriage, that's good and God-given. You have celibacy, which is even higher than that. And so the distortion of this is a real shame because it means that in many Protestant circles, there's no place for holy celibates. So if you're someone who aspires to be in ministry or wants to lead in any way or share your gifts, there's an enormous pressure to get married based on this really distorted misreading of St. Paul.
Eric?
Yeah. Oh, yes, I like that very much.
Okay. That'll be helpful to you?
Yes, it is, especially those verses there from Matthew.
Very good.
Yeah, Matthew, I didn't go very deeply in 1 Corinthians 7, but all of 1 Corinthians 7 is St. Paul talking about marriage. And then in verse 8, he says to the unmarried, and the widows, I say that it is well for them to remain single as I do. He acknowledges him that he is celibate. And then he says, but if they cannot exercise self-control, they should marry. For it is better to marry than to be aflame with passion. So in two verses, he literally says, celibacy is better than marriage. Marriage is better than living in lust.
Eric, thanks. Hang on though. Don't go anywhere. We want to send you that book. So hang on. And congratulations again on the new baby.
Yeah, congrats on the son.
Patrick's in Newfane, New York, listening on Catholic.com. That's our website, Catholic.com. Patrick, thank you for the call. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hello, Patrick. Do you think that human beings made in the image and likeness of God as mind-body-soul composites form a near-perfect image of the Trinity?
That's a good question. I want to nuance Oh, go ahead. Oh. Sorry, go ahead. I'm going to, you know, please. I didn't know you had more.
I would quote Catechism 368 and 1 Thessalonians 5:23 and compare our death to Revelations 22:1.
So it's a good question. There are these dimensions, you know, soul and body. And there is, of course, a sense in which we are made in the image of God. But we don't use the particular kind of the soul-body distinction as an image for the Trinity for a pretty simple reason. The soul is not the body is not the soul, but they also aren't one thing. In other words, you can have the two separated, the soul and body separate in death, where the Trinity is actually inseparable. So it's not just that you can't, you can like logically distinguish them, they're just separate things. So soul and body together comprise a person. But we don't want to say that the Father is one third of God or anything like that. And so a related, but I think a stronger analogy using the human person is based on the interiority of man. And so St. Augustine in On the Trinity, I believe it is, compares the Trinity to the mind, the knowledge by which the mind knows itself, and the love by which the mind loves itself. That if you think about that, that you can distinguish love, knowledge, and mind in some way, and there you'll find various shades of that, but it isn't like your mind is just one third of your mind, or its knowledge is just one third of your mind. It's not like that, that all of this is immaterial. And so that is, I think, a stronger sort of depiction of the Trinity. As for anything being a near perfect image of the Trinity, I don't think we have such a thing. I think in all of the Trinitarian images and analogies, they're weak branches. We can climb the tree, but don't spend too much time sitting on just one of them. So if thinking about the duality of man helps you a little bit, okay, but don't overdo it, because there's a lot of discontinuity. There's a lot of dissimilarity. Likewise, with even like the psychological analogy, which is what it's called, that Augustine gives us, that is helpful, but it's not perfect. There are no perfect, or I would say even really near perfect, analogies that get to this divine reality.
Patrick, thank you very much for the call. I'm going to keep moving because there are quite a few folks on the line. Gil, our old friend in New York, listening on Ave Maria Radio. Gil, welcome back. Hi,
hello.
Gil.
Hi, yeah, good evening.
Good evening.
May God be glorified.
Amen, brother.
A delay there. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, you're coming through fine. I'll tell you what, you just go ahead and ask your question, and then we'll let Joe answer it, and if we're not doing too much back and forth, you won't, the delay won't matter.
All right, may God be glorified. I want to mention Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, and another verse I'll give you. Just wish they get rid of the echo, though. Okay.
You're not coming through echoey. You're okay.
You sound good, Gil.
You sure? Okay, let's try again. Can you hear me now?
Oh, wait, we could hear you all fine right. The whole time.
Still getting that echo, though.
Yeah, right. I'll tell you what happened, and it's very unfortunate. Sometimes that happens, Gil. There's a stray electron goes awry somewhere, and you're just going to hear that echo when you're talking. So if you asked us if Joe could expound on Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 6.
Yeah, let me mention it. I'll take my ear off the phone. Okay. It says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. And the other verse is Psalm 119, verse 105, says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. There we go.
All right, yeah. Gil, we'll leave.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead. Pop Gil down. He's going to listen off the air, and we'll let Joe address these.
Yes. So I think those are good edifying passages. Just I don't know if there's a particular question there, but I think it's a good reminder that one of the dangers we can fall into is trying to direct everything ourselves, trying to figure out our own meaning and purpose. There's a famous passage in a Supreme Court plurality decision where it talks about at the heart of freedom being this idea to create our own meaning in the world. And that's actually a terribly nihilistic vision, because that is only possible in a world that's meaningless. In other words, if I'm looking at a math problem, there's an actual answer to that. And if I'm instead told, you know, freedom is just making up your own answer, okay, that suggests there's a certain meaninglessness. And so we can easily fall into this false vision of freedom, this false vision that it is not only my right, but even my duty to create meaning in my life. And that is bleak and that is false. That it is God who made you and who understands who you are and what you're about better than you do. And so meaning isn't something that you invent. Meaning at its core is something that you instead discover, but you can't discover it entirely on your own, which is why, as Proverbs 3, 5 to 6 says, we trust in the Lord with all of our heart. We don't rely on our own insight, and that instead we acknowledge him and allow him to make straight our paths. So it is that sense that meaning is something we receive from God rather than something that we give to ourselves. So I don't know if that's the direction Gil was hoping we'd go, but that's one of the things I really love about that passage.
Now, could you just give the same answer, but use echo the whole time? No, don't do that. Sorry, Gil, about the echo. It's usually just, it's easy to talk with you, and that was a little difficult, but we'll talk again. So we'll look forward to that. Andy's in Wisconsin listening on the Catholic Answers app. Andy, thank you for waiting. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
So actually, my question is for you, Si.
Oh, like the other Gretzky brother.
What? I'm about to be Brett Gretzky.
So I watched the video that you guys sent out to the Society 315 the other day, where you gave that talk about evangelizing Jesus in like the techno world.
Yes.
And first, I was very disappointed there was no techno music there, so the title misled me.
Do you know you're not the only person who was upset that there was no techno music? I think that Zach, who produced that, I think he actually suggested that we play techno music, and I think I nixed it. So I apologize
for
that.
You're just like, techno.
I don't actually know what techno music is, so I just
think a lot of what Gil was hearing on the last call was just techno and yeah, you know, even that was electronic distortion. Right.
Okay, but so well, I'm glad you watched the talk. Thank you. What was your question?
Yeah. So at the end of it, you mentioned how one of the remedies for today is to build intentional communities, and I was wondering if you actually had examples. Like instead of like high level things, but like actual concrete examples that you have seen, or Joe, you can answer too if you've seen these, of groups who have actually made these kind of communities. Because usually my experience in the church, whenever there are attempts at making these communities, they either feel kind of forced or sort of empty. So
I just have good examples. But I didn't understand one thing you said, not high level things. What does that mean, not high level things?
I was looking for more like practical advice for it. So rather than just saying like, oh, we need, like your example in the talk was JP2, like had a community, but that was kind of, you know, back then. So like today, have you seen a group where like you've gone to a parish mission or something and you saw like people were like, we did like X, Y, Z in order to like make these communities and it's been going really well.
Yeah, the kind of the dream there or the ideal would be if that was the parish, if the parish was itself a community that gathered around the sacraments out of love for Jesus the Lord and then went out in charity together into the world to share the good news the truth is we've talked about many times on this show, there are lots of sociological and historical reasons why parishes are not working that way right now. But that would be ideal. And there are people who are doing wonderful stuff in some parishes. But you want practical stuff. And the reason I asked you about why you said not high-level things, because I do think there is a tendency in the modern world. I had it myself for many, many years, and I criticize it in myself now. I think I've let go of it. And that is to say, what we need is new forms of community. Because the old forms of community, especially monastic communities, are really, really good. And I think after the Second Vatican Council, many people thought, well, it's time to move on and create, you know, like Dorothy Day was doing or whatnot. And I am all in favor of what Dorothy Day was doing. But the first thing people should ask themselves is, do I have a vocation to a monastic, priestly, or other religious life? Because those are the tried and trues. Those work. And I actually am of the mind that there are probably hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of people who God is calling into monastic life, into Christian communal life, maybe into the mendicant life with the Dominicans and the Franciscans. And people are missing that call. So that's why I asked about the high level thing, because, and I'm going to continue this on the other side. But I think the first thing we should do is really think about monastic community, and young women should think about being sisters, and young men should think about being brothers. And we should think about these as not an old-fashioned thing, but as the next wave. But we'll talk with Joe about it, get his take on the other side. Excitement is building for Catholic Answers Annual Apologetics Conference, I Believe in God. There's still time to join us September 21st through 24th in sunny San Diego as we welcome Scott Hahn and an all-star lineup of speakers, as well as your favorite Catholic Answers apologists. Join us for a conference that is sure to ignite, encourage, and inform your faith. Seats are still available, but they're going fast. Visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 888-291-8000.
If you're not a Bible scholar, the full message of how the Sunday Mass readings fit together can be tough to comprehend. Apologist Carlo Broussard is here to help. Join Carlo every Friday for the Sunday Catholic Word Podcast. In each episode, he unpacks the scripture readings for that Sunday and brings them all together so you can better understand and defend the faith. Visit SundayCatholicWord.com to subscribe. That's SundayCatholicWord.com.
Want to get right to the core of Christ's saving message? Want a roadmap for living the life Christ calls you to? It's time to look again at the Beatitudes. In his new book, Heart of the Gospel, How the Beatitudes Show Us God's Plan for Happiness, Father Sebastian Walsh demonstrates compellingly how these eight declarations make up the foundation, the essence, and the final goal of Jesus' teaching. Heart of the Gospel illuminates the scriptural passages from which we get the Beatitudes, explains the significance of their wording, their order, and their timing in Jesus's ministry. And it draws out edifying parallels and connections with salvation history and the lives of the saints. Most importantly, Father Walsh offers wise counsel from his own work as a priest and teacher to help you live the Beatitudes in your own life. Order your copy of Heart of the Gospel today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hi, this is Johnette Williams. We bring you the truth of the Catholic faith on Women of Grace tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest. It is open forum this hour. Your call is welcome, 888-318-7884. But somewhat unusually, Andy from Wisconsin called and asked me a question. Usually I don't do the question answering, but it was in reference to a talk that I gave recently regarding kind of how to address how to be a Christian in a hyper-technical world. That was kind of the theme of the thing. And among the things that I said was we needed radical Christian communities, and we needed to be, we need to live in them in a radical way. And so, Andy was asking if I had any ideas about that. So all I was saying before the break, Andy, was that I don't think we should turn up our nose at the kind of communities that have already existed for a long time. And I think particularly monastic communities, I do think more young women and men should consider monastic life. I think they would be really happy in monastic life. Many, many of them would. Many who don't think that they would be should try it, because they may in fact be. And I do think that those communities already have, you know, 1,500 years of tradition to help them be stable and fruitful. But on a less kind of old-fashioned note, or a less traditional note, I also think, Andy, that there are people are building these kind of communities. And I'll just give you an example here at Catholic Answers. That's a form of work community around sharing the gospel. Or you will find mothers groups, or you find these beautiful groups in many parishes, which are called grieving groups or the grieving ministry, where they help people who are grieving. And grieving is not a five-day thing. You have the funeral and it's over. These are people who are walking with the grieving. And many of these are quite stable communities, very, very Christian. Anyone can join. And they're very, very fruitful. So those would be my ideas. Joe, I don't know. Do you have some thoughts?
Yeah, I think that's all very good. I think the danger we run into is overthinking community and being maybe unrealistic. Like, okay, let's all move into the exact same place and we'll all just live together in a compound.
Like the monkeys.
Division or whatever. You mean the zoo or the band?
The band, the monkeys. They all lived in a house together.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That is a real thing that happened.
Sorry about that. Go ahead.
Yes. No, it's all right. I'd forgotten that part of the show. I used to watch that. But what I was going to say is, like, in my own life, I guess two things. One, it's really dangerous to try to go to heaven alone. And if you want, I believe it's the Office of Readings for January 3rd. It's St. Gregory and St. Basil. They have a common feast day and they were friends. And it's a reminder that we have the obligation to help each other get to heaven. And it's so much easier if you have someone you can lean on and that who can kind of support you on the way. And so Gregory and Basil talk about seeing in one another a standard of holiness, that they would look to the other person when they would otherwise maybe have lost their way. And so that's really important and really helpful. It's, you know, one of the reasons why we're born into families and why families have such an obligation and responsibility, because family is really the first place this community should be playing out, that your family should be a tiny, you know, as St. John Paul II calls it, a domestic church, a little church in the home where it's a small society ordered towards God. And then you can build other friend groups, whether it's friends or families that you're close to, and kind of build out from there. And that might just mean touching in with each other, opening up with each other, spending time together. It doesn't have to be a really complicated thing. We're going to go through these books in this order. In my life, and I think in the life of most people, it plays out just in saying, okay, I'll give you an example. I've got three guys I regularly get in touch with. And so we try to get together once a month. That obviously doesn't happen all the time. And then after we get together, we look at our calendars and say, okay, is there a time a month from now we can get together? And it's that level of intentionality. It's one night a month, roughly. And then if it's a month, it's more like one night every 6 weeks or 2 months or 3 months. But it's just having a time to be there together. And we can kind of be open about what everything going on or the highs and the lows. And it's really edifying and supporting. And I was talking with another friend who complained about how he doesn't have that. And so I think there's a hunger for this. And a need. And I think I see it in a lot of men. I'm sure it's in a lot of women as well. This sense of like, we are not meant to just be traveling alone through this journey. And so it's not crazy to just say, I don't know, invite another family over for dinner or brunch, or just, hey, we're going to go to the park. Do you want to go to the park with us? Or I think there's a special role single people play in this on both sides. They're often the loneliest. They're also often the ones that have the most time. So if you're an extrovert or if you're someone good at hosting, take that initiative very seriously and invite others into your life.
Andy, any of that what you were looking for?
Yeah. Yes. I think the part of like just kind of not overthinking it, I guess the questions I would have later, but I'll maybe call another time, would be like, what do you actually like get out of these communities or how do you feel about them to kind of know if you're actually in one or not? But I've taken enough time, so I don't want to. Okay. Keep taking more time.
Although Joe, well, hang on, because I do want to send you a book because nobody ever asked me a question. So I feel like I want to send you a book, but did you want to address what Andy just said?
Yes. I want to suggest a book by St. Elred of Rivoleu called Spiritual Friendship. And he's exploring, why do we need friends? He's exploring it as a medieval monk, which is really fascinating. And it's one of the few works I know on the good of friendship and on the types of friendship. And the whole thing is a conversation between him and another monk that he's friends with. And so even the format is really beautiful because it speaks to this role that iron sharpens iron. So what does a friend group or a community of any kind provide? I think it provides several things. One, it speaks to the fact that man is a social animal. We were not meant to be alone. not good that man should be alone. That even a celibate, and in some ways especially a celibate, is called to still be in community, not in radical isolation. Even radically, the hermits, the people who lived in solitude, would still be visited by people who they would care for. And so even they didn't live alone, and they were in spiritual communion with the whole church. And so they were constantly lifting up others and their needs in prayer. And so we want to recognize that this fulfills a basic human need that we have, and it fulfills or helps us to fulfill our spiritual duty to take care of our neighbor. But they can also do a lot of other things. If you're struggling in a certain area, having someone you can talk through, whether it's a doubt or a sin or whatever, can be really helpful. But also just having a common life. The people you spend the most time with are the ones you're going to most emulate. As our Lord said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So if you spend time investing in mass media and popular culture, that's where your heart's going to be. If you spend time investing in God and neighbor, that's where your heart's going to be. And so that's what I think it provides.
Hang on, Andy. We'll send you a copy of The Eucharist is Really Jesus if you'd like it. All you got to do is hang on the phone and give us an address, and we'll send it off to you. And thank you for the opportunity to have that conversation.
Send him your book as well.
Okay, let's send him two books. We'll also send him A Teacher of Strange Things, who Jesus was, what he taught, and why people still follow him. Anything else that you want me to do before I go on, Joe?
No, that's good.
Okay. All right. Very good.
I noticed you liked my answer, so I just wanted to make sure everybody else noticed that too.
I don't think I didn't. Let's just put it that way. Don't think I didn't notice that. Scott's in Pittsburgh, listening on the Amazon Alexa. Scott, thank you for the call. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hi, how you doing?
Very well.
How are you?
That's good. Good, thank you. I want to know, I'm a former Catholic, but I still prefer to go to confession in the Catholic Church. Because of the privacy. And, I'm just wondering, am I under an obligation, or do I have to, or is it wrong or illicit, or, in Catholic terms, would it be a mortal sin to not tell the priest that I'm a former Catholic who is fellowshipping currently in a Protestant church, but is that wrong of me to not tell the priest that?
That's a very good question. You should definitely tell the priest that, and here's why. When we have a twofold relationship in religion, we have a relationship with God, and we have a relationship with neighbor, and especially in our Christian neighbor, in the upbuilding of the body of Christ, and so. We talk about the communion with Christ, the head, and also with the church, the body of Christ. And it's one communion. And so when you're dealing with the sacrament of confession, there's a healing that's happening in both of those ways. And so for this reason, under canon law, typically only Catholics can go to confession. Now, that doesn't mean they have to be good Catholics or in confession, right? Like they're Catholics who are wanting to be restored to union. There are certain circumstances in which the priest can hear the confession of a non-Catholic. And this is one of the reasons why you should just put all your cards on the table and kind of explain how things are. Your case is actually a little more complicated because under canon law, it sounds like you've got a Catholic baptism. So you are, in a real sense, a Catholic from our perspective. But you don't want to be restored to full union with the Catholic Church, right? Like you want to still fellowship with a Protestant church, I'm assuming, and not come entirely home to the Catholic Church. Is that fair to say?
Yes, that is fair to say.
Okay. So, and I don't say that in the spirit of condemnation, but just that's really good information for the priest to have, so he doesn't think something is going on that isn't. And then he can give you counsel, and he may or may not be able to give you absolution depending on the circumstances, but he can at least, you can have a private confession, and he can be considered bound by the seal. Dioceses have given rules on this, so you don't have to worry about the priest blabbing it to somebody else. So you can have the privacy that you're looking for. You can have the spiritual counsel. I don't know if you believe in the graces of sacramental absolution or not, but that would be the one thing that it would probably not be possible to provide here.
Okay. I actually do believe in the graces of sacramental absolution. And I guess my feeling was, is that I understand that,
you know, why there's a prohibition of people who aren't in full communion with the church not receiving the Eucharist. And I agree with that, because it's like you have to be, I do believe that you have to be fully believing that this is, you know, Christ in the Eucharist and, you know, in a, you know, in good standing, you know, because that's even in the Bible that you have to be in good,
that's right,
moral standing to receive the Eucharist. But, you know, to me, it's, you know, I guess I was feeling that, well, confession should be, you know, forgiveness should be in a something that's available for everybody, you know, and anybody. And I guess that's, you know.
Yeah,
and,
so in, mean, one like, sense, and, in one sense, it is. But the difficulty is, if you want to be restored in your relationship to Jesus, the head, but not restored in your relationship with Jesus's body. And so that's where things get more complicated. Because if, okay, if we take seriously this idea the church is the body of Christ that St. Paul talks about, and if the church is a visible society, like a city on a hill, like Jesus does, then it's dangerous to say, I want to be in communion with the shepherd, but not the flock. And so this creates all kinds of issues. So it sounds like you're in a really fascinating kind of spiritual place in terms of the things that you, it sounds like you still share and believe that are pretty distinctively Catholic. So if I could, I don't want to be too aggressive, but if can I just give you an email that you could, I'd love to hear more about your journey and see if I can help in any way, kind of maybe get to some of the issues that are more at the heart of what caused you to leave. And if there's anything that there's still like questions you've got, but at radio@catholic.com, they'll pass your email along to me. And I'd be happy to kind of keep this conversation going and kind of explore, yeah, what are the possibilities available here?
Okay. Yeah.
I mean, if you're comfortable, the ball's in your court. I don't want to push you, but if you're comfortable, if you're interested, I'd love to hear more about your journey and kind of get a deeper sense.
Okay. I'll consider that. So it's, the email is radio@catholic.com.
But the other thing you can do is just hang on the line and Edgar will get an email address from you.
Oh,
but
yeah,
you may want more time.
If you want to do that. But if you want, you know, yeah, he can give you my direct address as well. But it's up to you if you want to. I don't want to, you know, I don't want to force you into a conversation you're not ready for or comfortable with.
Yeah, maybe that's the way to do it, Scott. Maybe we'll give you Joe's address and then you use it whenever, when and if you decide that's what you want to do.
Okay.
Okay, hang on. Edgar will get it for you. Edgar doesn't know how to spell Heschmeyer, though, I'm pretty sure. I
don't worry, you don't have to. It's
does,
not...
does anybody, do you know how to spell Heschmeyer? I mean, I forwarded
an email I got to my wife and said, what should I do in responding to this? And she said, oh, the school misspelled our last name the same way. And then it turned out it was not even misspelled in the same way. So I was like, do you know how to spell our name? There's an extra letter missing here.
Well, I mean, when she married you, you didn't tell her there was going to be a test, did you?
I know. It's like,
leave her alone.
An easy last name to Heschmeyer. So
thanks,
that was
Scott.
The first sign it was going to be just more of a burden to be married to me.
All right, we got to take a break. We will be right back with more Open Forum with Joe Heschmeyer right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
You're listening to Catholic Answers Live. Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
One time somebody said to me, why don't you air these people? And I said, no, because I don't think they're Catholic. He says, by what right do you have to say that? I said, I own the network.
Mother Angelica Live Classics, every morning, 2 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Who was the first Catholic in your family? Were they evangelized by a friend, a coworker, a stranger? Did you ever think that you could be that person that God uses to save a soul? And that soul could save their family, their grandchildren, and generations to come? At St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, we train, equip, and mobilize Catholic disciples to do the urgent work of evangelization. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. StreetEvangelization.com.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kelliger, host. Our guest is Joe Heschmeyer. It's spelled with an H. And we started this show by saying we didn't know if Joe was going to make it to the end of the program with us.
No baby yet.
But apparently still waiting for the baby. One thing I would ask of our listeners, if you would be kind enough to do so, please say a prayer for Anna as she prepares to deliver their third.
If anyone asks, just say I had the foresight to make that request.
Well, yeah, as Joe wanted to say, if you've got a prayer for, and for all moms going through that, the crucible of childbirth. But soon, Joe, one thing I have noticed about pregnancy is they do come to an end at some point. You do get a baby. Yeah.
Yeah. Jesus actually compares the suffering that both he and I think the disciples are going to undergo to childbirth, where after it happens, you're just like, oh, this is amazing. This is wonderful. And it's actually a good model of suffering. That, like, hey, this is horrible. Let's not pretend it's not.
Right.
But some good will come out of this.
Right. Have you ever met a woman who's pregnant? Like, you meet her when she's pregnant, and then you have a weird kind of surprise when you see her later and she's not pregnant. Like, you thought, oh, she's a pregnant lady. And I just met a pregnant woman, but I'm probably the only one who
I think
that.
You might be the only one of those. I would love to hear if like later share this later, idea of not understanding how pregnancy works.
So well, no, it's not that I don't understand. It's just
that pregnancy lasts for a short time. He's telling himself.
I don't. The depths of my ignorance are probably hard to plumb, but let's go to Michael in Los Angeles. I don't know. It's just a weird thing. Like, you meet a woman and you think that's how she looks. And then you see her like 6 months later and go, oh, that lady who I met was pregnant. That's not actually how she looks. This is how she looks with a baby.
I'm not touching this one with a 10-foot pole.
Good Lord, help me. Michael.
I'm sorry, pregnant women. Cy is praying for you. He doesn't understand that that is pregnancy.
It's not an intellectual thing. Good Lord. Michael in Los Angeles, watching on YouTube, please save me, Michael. Why do I get into trouble when Joe's on? Go ahead, Michael.
Yes, I have a weird question. Well, it's not really that weird. I have a friend who was baptized Catholic, and then when she got older, she married a Muslim man and converted to Islam, but she was baptized and confirmed Catholic. So I don't know what's the deal, what would happen to her in case she passes away and dies. You know, I'm not sure if someone leaving a Catholic faith into Islam or another religion automatically makes you a possible going to hell.
It's a good question. So we want to be clear on a couple things. Number one, there is no other name under heaven which we've been given by which we're to be saved than Jesus Christ. That everyone who is saved through Jesus. And the relationship we have with Jesus is very different as Christians than the relationship in Islam, because they deny that Jesus is actually God. And they deny that he's the Son of God. They deny that he actually died on the cross. So they believe he's a great prophet. They have a lot of respect for some of his teachings, but they don't believe the same things we believe about Jesus. And so this is a spiritually dangerous place to be, because they can't put their trust in Jesus in the same way. They believe there's a necessity of Muhammad to come along as a further prophet. And so there's all of these things that are important dimensions. So those are things that should give us pause. Those are things that should give us a great concern to pray for people who leave Christianity for Islam, because it is spiritually dangerous. You are taking your salvation kind of into your hand. But we want to caveat that to not rush into immediately judging and condemning those to hell, because God knows which things are conscious, knowledgeable, willful sort of acts of betrayal, and which things are innocent, even attempts to try to find him and are just misunderstandings. And here I would say this. On the cross, Jesus prays for his persecutors, people who put him to death. And he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Now, the people who put him to death, by our standards, it seemed like they knew perfectly well what they were doing. But Jesus sees in them that there was an ignorance that he sees as a basis for them to be forgiven. And so we should take all of that seriously, that this is a grave error. This is something we should encourage her away from. We should pray for her in, and we should take very seriously. But on the other hand, we don't just rush to, oh, you're definitely going to hell, you're definitely damned, because we haven't been given that kind of insider knowledge. So, you know, the U.S. seal on the, like the presidential seal, it has an eagle, and it's got 13 arrows in one hand, or beak, or in a talon, whatever, and 13 olive branches in the other. And the idea is, we prepare for war, but we look to peace. We want peace, but we're preparing for the worst. And so likewise, we should prepare for the fact that people we love may go to hell if we are just apathetic, or if we sit back and don't say anything. But we don't want to just assume that. So we want to prepare for the worst, but we want to hope for the best at the same time.
Michael, I'm going to say thank you and continue moving. I do know where babies come from. I'm just going to say that before I go on to the next one. And Joe's being really mean.
I hope
to
someone
me.
Tuned in and had no context.
Yeah, completely out of context statement. Oh my gosh. Good for Cy. He figured it out.
Let's go to Terry in Wisconsin. I think.
All right, Terry. Thank you for helping me, Joe. You could see that I didn't know which one to go to. Yeah. Watch it on YouTube. Terry, thanks for the call. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
My question is about the Nicene Creed. Is there a really good commentary to read to go into deeper study of it?
Yeah, I think a good place to start is the Catechism of the Catholic Church. So part one of the Catechism is called Profession of Faith, and it's just a slow kind of unpacking about what we believe, and it really goes through the creed basically line by line in section two, and it's very lengthy. And so, yeah, I think if you look at that, you'll get a much deeper kind of explanation of what each part of the creed means from a reliable source.
Terry?
Yeah.
That work?
Thank you. Yeah, that sounds good.
All right. You're very, very welcome. You can, if you don't have the Catechism of the Catholic Church, it is available online. So you can always read all that Joe suggested right there online.
And Felix, I might have time for Felix. Yeah.
All right, Felix, I'm glad you did, because I just said his name in Dustin, Florida, listening on 690 AM. Felix, thank you very much for the call. You're going to have to be quick if you'd like an answer from Joe.
Yes. Thank you, gentlemen. This is a difficult question to ask, but I'll try to keep it as few words as possible. I have been a friend of mine showed me a posting by a Catholic source that alleges that the third secret of Our Lady of Fatima was not fully divulged, that Saint Lucia, the oldest of the three peasant children, told it to Pope John Paul.
Okay, I'm going to have to get Joe's comment on the last. Was it divulged or not?
I mean, Benedict XVI said it was divulged, that the third secret of Fatima was divulged. And there are a lot of people who don't believe him, but I have no idea who I would trust more than Benedict XVI. And I don't think the people I'd put in that category would be random people from the internet.
Felix, I'm sorry that I know it felt like we were rushing you there at the end, but we actually were rushing you. We had to zip. But thank you very much. If that was not adequate, please call back tomorrow.
Yeah, I'm sure that was very brusque. So sorry about that.
Joe Heschmeyer. Next time I see you, I think you'll have number three.
Yeah.
I know you. He always does this to me. I know number three already exists and Jesus already loves baby number three, but number three will be out here in the world with the rest of us. Was that acceptable?
Amen.
Wait. Okay, good. God bless you. God bless Anna. Lots of people praying for you. Please do pray for Joe and Anna as they get ready to welcome any minute now baby number three. See you tomorrow for more Open Forum, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.